want to hear you sing a little. Here we go. Let's try to get our voices warmed up. Rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand.
All of the ground is sinking sand.
So stop your feet and clap your hands.
So stop your feet and clap your hands.
Our feet are on the rock.
Our feet are on the rock.
Do it again. On Christ the solid rock I stand.
On Christ the solid rock I stand.
All of the ground is sinking sand.
All of the ground is sinking sand.
So stop your feet and clap your hands.
So stop your feet and clap your hands.
Our feet are on the rock. Here we go.
Our feet are on the rock.
On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand.
Good morning, everyone. Now, I need you all to have as much energy as me. I'm a little bit tired. Only a little bit of caffeine. Yeah, it's dangerous. Dangerous. So, have you smiled at somebody that, you know, you don't speak to that much yet? Nah, don't lie. We in church. Go ahead and greet your brother and sister in Christ. Let them know you're happy to see them. Say good morning. Wave at them. I want you to experience the energy and the joy of not only coming and dwelling with God, but dwelling with one another. And that'll be the theme throughout the day. That we have this relationship with God. But God also expects us to have a relationship with one another. And so as we are about to go into praise and worship, I want to read you one thing, and then we're going to stand up together and start worshiping. This is from Howard Thurman, one of my favorite theologians. He talks about it this way, and we all know that when we talk about God, we're talking about love. If you're talking about love, you're talking about God. And if you would stand with me, Howard Thurman explains love this way. Love has no awareness of merit or demerit. It has no scale. Love loves. That is its nature. So I invite you this morning that as we worship and as we sing and as we listen and embrace each other, you are invited to be loved, to be cared for, no matter your past, because God is God, the nature of God loves. Amen? Let's worship.
I is no distance. It cannot be covered over and over. You're not defenseless. I'll be your shelter.
My darkness to rescue me. He took me out of my calamity and my chaos, and he drew me to himself, taking me from the depths of my despair. When I was at my weakest, the Lord held on to me. His love broke open the way. Say that with me. His love broke open the way. Say it again. His love broke open the way. If you need that today, just reach up. Just let him grab you. He's reaching out today. He sees you. He knows you. There is no distance. Let's sing that verse again.
There is no distance that cannot be covered. Over and over, you're not defenseless. Shelter, I'll be your armor. I hear you whisper underneath your breath. I hear your SOS, your SOS.
You can stay right where you are. So as we were singing this song, I was reminded of something that kept happening last week as I was away in North Carolina. And every morning I would wake up at like 5:30 and try and catch this sunrise. And for that first hour, like before the sunrise, nobody was out. Then like 2 minutes before it was supposed to rise, you just start seeing like all these people like emerging onto the beach right before it would happen. And the way we could see it there was literally, you know, this huge orange ball would just like rise out of the horizon. And, you know, as we're singing this song, what I sensed was the sun is gonna rise no matter what. And that rescue is gonna come no matter what. It's there, it's always there. But I felt like there's people in here today who need to get up out of their bed and go run to see that sun and say, okay, it's rising. I'm not alone. and I need that rescue. I need to see that that thing is going to come out of that earth and everything is going to be okay. And so if you're one of those people today who you're like, I got to run out to the beach at dark so that I can just make sure and get a glimpse of my rescue, because yes, it will rescue me, but I am going to get my rescue. So today, if you need a rescue in whatever way, I just want to invite you to come up here. Maybe you've never done that before. And Cindy came up and she said, I just feel like people, it's time to come up to the altar for this song. So if you're uncomfortable, it's just about a movement, right? Because if you're in the house, the sun's still going to rise. But if you go out to the beach, you're going to see it and you're going to feel it. And something's going to break over your dawn. So I just want to invite you to come up. Just come up. We're going to sing this song one more time. If you need somebody to just pray over you, if you need some sun to rise on you this morning, just come on up, and we're just going to sing this song one more time, and we're going to pray for you. Thank you.
drowning in the ocean of worry, anxiety. Let him put your feet on the rock, reaching over you, pouring that you've even gone to win my war. You come back with the head of my enemy. You come back and you call it my victory. Oh, yes you do. You've even gone to win my war. Your love becomes my greatest defense. Leads me from the dry wilderness. And all I did was pray. It was worship you, Jesus. All I did was bow down. All I did was stay still.
God's just moving in my spirit this morning, church. There's somebody, or maybe a couple people in this room, that feel like they're broken into too many pieces, and God can't put them back together again. Well, I'm here to tell you, I was broken in a million pieces. What you see now is not Cindy 30 years ago. And I can tell you, he put me back together again. It may not be to where you think I should be, but I know he put me back together again. And I can say he did a pretty good job. So don't ever think that you are too broken that God cannot put you back together again. Let him do the fixing. Amen?
Amen. Through the darkness, through the unknowing, through the expected falling through, and then the surprise of the unexpected on the other side, God is with us through it all. His love, their love endures through it all. Their love finds every piece, calls them all back together, doesn't discard anything. We can venture out into all of this unknown because we have God and their love as a tether. It keeps us connected. It's loose enough that lets us move and try and experiment and explore, but it's got us if we fall or if we misplace a hand or if we get stuck. It's there for us every time. And this place is a place like that, that we want to be that kind of love and experience for one another. That when you're like, man, I'm feeling low, or I feel like I don't know, or I'm just confused, or I'm just feeling unsettled, that this is a place where all of us can come with all of our brokenness, all our varied degrees of brokenness, and we can all come and help one another be put back together. We can all be encouragers of one another as we look beside us and see someone else be put back together. That, to me, is church. Like, that's the work of Jesus into which we're all called. Amen. And as we transition into other parts of the service, I pray that we would hold on to that. Hold on to that truth, onto that reality. As we go into the Word, as we turn that over and over in us, we would feel that same love pouring through those words to us. As the preacher brings what they've prepared, and then the Spirit interprets that to each one of us in the way that only the Spirit can do. I pray that work would continue. Yes, I know. I didn't forget. I don't know how to transition into that. I'm getting cues. Thank you for your generous giving. Kevin, don't forget that there's an offering before the preacher. Yes, there is. And it is important work. So yes, you can come on up. Tony, Dave, thank you for your faithful participation every week in ushering and ensuring this gets done too. This is important work, and I don't know why I feel so awkward talking about it, because this is a necessary aspect of this happening, right? I mean, this doesn't just happen. These places don't just exist without all of us pulling together whatever resources we can to sustain their work. So if you believe in what is going on in this church, in this experiment that we call Cornerstone, in this journey that we are all going on with God, I invite you to participate in any way that you can. There are multiple ways that you can give financially to this place. They're on the screen. You can text a tithe. You can set up a tithe. I mean, I set mine up where I just set it up and it goes in every week. I don't have to think about it. Every Friday, it is transferred from my account the church, no matter if I'm here or not, or if I'm on vacation or not, because I believe so deeply and put my personhood behind what I believe is happening in this place and believe it is worth supporting. So I invite you to do the same, that you can participate in this work in that way. There's a QR code that you can scan that'll take you to that if you want to pay through text. So God, we pray that you would take everything that we can bring, that no gift is too meager, no gift is too great. When it is given generously and given with the wholeness of ourselves, without restraint, without withholding, God, we offer it to you. We offer it as an offering freely. And we know that you will bless that. We ask you to bless that. We ask you to bless the hands that give it, to continue to pour into their lives so that we can continue to pour into one another's. Amen. And now we want to invite all of our children. Children, you can perk up your ears, take out your earplugs, listen now. This is time for Kingdom Kids. So all children in this place, we invite you back to the back with Miss Steph. Yes. There's a special place for you today. We pray over you as you go. We love you guys. And there's a special place for all of us in here today as well. This is a very exciting Sunday because it is a crossroads. After 2 years and 8 months, we have arrived at the end of the book of John. And to shepherd us through those last couple verses, we have what, one or two verses left, Pastor James? Two verses left. We are 2 verses away, y'all. I can feel it. I think it's gonna happen. I mean, there are 2 verses, so I don't know, maybe we'll do one this week, one next week. I tease. But we are blessed to have Pastor James with us this morning, bringing us these final 2 words. If you've been in this place a week, you know what a gift James is to this body. So it is such a blessing that we have him here this morning with a prepared word. It was going to go another direction this morning, but James was inspired to bring something with these last couple of verses. And so I am very excited to hear what he has to bring. So if you could help bring up Pastor Jim, you'll be good. He said no pressure. He can handle the pressure. So yes, bring him on up, Pastor James.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. As the pressure builds, well, it's so good to see you and so good to have the opportunity to speak in front of you this morning. And what I want to do is kind of marry this all together as we look back on the book of John and the things that John is trying to express to us and some of the things that we may have remembered over the last 2 years and 8 months. And so I'll start with this. Now, I'm putting you on the spot. This is kind of like being in class and the professor gives you a pop quiz when you walk in, right? Unfair, but still done. And that is, what is one thing that sticks out for you in the book of John. What has it been? Anybody? Can't remember? God is clingy. Right? All right, wait, so I got to write some of these down. God is clingy, right? Sandra brought that. What are some other ones? Because I'm going to weave this in.
No, I'm just going to make sure everyone can hear. You mean from the book of John or from the
sermons? Either.
Wildly different
than the others.
John might be a little full of himself.
Might be full of himself. Okay. Yep.
The disciples made a lot of mistakes. They were very human. They were just ridiculous sometimes, but God loved them and forgave them and used them.
Aren't we ridiculous sometimes? I'm glad they were. Right? Other thoughts, because this is good. This is good.
In the other gospels, Jesus tells parables. In the Gospel of John, Jesus is the parable.
Jesus is the parable. And online, if you're online and you had a thought, please put those in the chat and we'll try to integrate those as well.
Eternal life starts now.
Eternal life starts now. Y'all give me a lot to work with.
John is the rock.
John is the rock. So different from Peter. Okay. All right. Let's go. Others? Others? Okay. Up here front.
There's always different perspectives. We different tend to look at it from just Jesus's perspectives, but the Pharisees, the crowd, they all had a perspective and were trying to operate out of what they understood.
Yes.
There's no barrier that God won't break to come find us.
Okay, no barrier. All right, you guys have done very good. One more. I was afraid you guys would have missed and didn't remember anything.
Okay. One thing that really sticks out here is that St. Peter was always putting his foot in his mouth.
Okay.
And yet Jesus still used him.
Okay. Peter putting his foot in his mouth, but yet Jesus used him as well. Is there any? Not yet. Okay. So let's go from there, because I agree with you on every last one of these things that stuck out. And so we're going to see some of that as we try to recap John the book and some of the things that we have talked about over the last 2+ years. So, but first, let's read these two short verses, and then let's jump in and start integrating both what you recall and what John recalls about his relationship, his experience, his walk with Jesus through his 3.5 years of walk, or 3.5 or thereabout walk with Jesus, right? So it took us 2 years, 8 months to talk about 3.5 years of ministry, right? So a lot was going on. But before I go into that, let's pray. Dear God, I thank you for today. I thank you for this moment in time where we, the community, the family of Cornerstone Christian Fellowship, and those around the world that would listen to this, have this moment with you. We ask that you speak to us in only the way that you can. Make your word clear and your message resonate in our hearts. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. So let's read. If you would, the text will be on the screen. It says this, John 21, verses 24 through 25. It says, "This is the disciple who is testifying to these things and has written them. And we know that this testimony is true. But there are also many other things that Jesus did. If every one of them were written down, I suppose that the world itself could not contain the books that would be written." So in this close, John is just saying, look, I've told you a lot about my personal experience, but this is not nearly enough. Not nearly enough. And John is somewhat being a responsible speaker and writer. You know, at sometimes you have a lot to say, but you need to narrow it down. You need to focus. And so John is kind of giving us a heads up. These are the things that I want to pull out from my walk with Jesus. And these are just some things that are important to me. But I didn't walk with Jesus thinking I needed to document all of the pieces and miracles and wonderfulness of Jesus Christ. That was not my goal. But now that I'm in this point in my life, I do want to capture some things for you that stood out. I do want to leave you with something that tells you what was my experience. And in that experience, there were some good things. Right? There were some very good things. And then there's also the apology of John and say, I am so sorry that I left out some things that may have been important to you. I apologize. And there are also, John was aware, other gospels or other writings that could possibly help you fill your needs for what you need to know about Jesus. But this is mine, right? So Matthew, Mark, and Luke, they had different aims as well. So some of them would talk more about the theology of God and how Jesus met the requirements of the Old Testament of what the Messiah would be. Right? They'll tell you about that. Others will give you all the parables and the language that talks about the wonderfulness and the power that is kind of this majestic, distant God. That is their role. I have a different role that I want to share with you. I want to tell you about my relationship, personal relationship with Jesus, that may be missing in some of the other documents, right? So Dave mentioned that John may be a little bit full of himself, right? That there's this majestic God, but then John says, but I am the one he loved, right? So there's this difference. And where did that come from? How do we get there? I hope that each and every one of you get something out of this message today. But I want to let you know that my primary focus and the people I want to reach out to today are those that are lonely. Those that are in a period of time in their life where it seems like they have been separated and isolated and alone. Right? Why is that resonating with me right now? And when I talk about alone, I just mean disconnected, right? So you're isolated from people and true relationships, different from what we promote as a part of the community of Cornerstone of being, hey, we are joined and feel one another and look after one another and all promoting this unity through Jesus Christ. If you're not feeling that in your life, my call is to you today. Why is that important? And this is not just a religious journey and conversation that I want to have with you. This is something that is important to us as humans. right? So I want to read just some basic stats because I don't want to get these wrong. It said loneliness is a health crisis in Western society today, and that the lack of connection is exceeding the damage of inactivity, obesity, air pollution, and smoking 15 cigarettes a day. Loneliness. Since 2003, the average time an American adult spends alone has increased by 24 hours a month, right? So a whole day now, you're isolated and alone versus in 2003. You've lost a day each month of connection with someone. And at the same time, you are losing your time with friends, right? So you're totally alone, and then there's less time with friends. You're losing 20 hours away from being with friends. 2 days every month of reduced time of connectivity for each and every one of us on average every month here in the United States. And if you think it's just us old folks, young adults and teens, theirs has dropped 70%, right? As an older person, you're only using 2 days. But as these younger people, they're losing time face-to-face with one another, they've lost it by 70%. Close friendships, right, there's this measurement of how many friends should you have and when do you start reaching the danger zone, right? 3 is the number. If you are above 3, they say, okay, you're good. You kind of like mentally, you're in there. You're socially connected. If it's less than 3 or 3, you're in the danger zone. In 1990, that percentage was at 25%. In 2020, it was at 50%. Meaning people at 3 or less. Half of us are in the danger zone. Danger zone. And there are more bad news. Right? So one of it is just our mental state, but the other is our physical state. There's a 29% increase in the risk of heart disease. There's a 32% increase in stroke. There's a 50% increase in the risk of dementia as you get older. And there's an increased risk of premature death by 60%. All by not having connection. And you're like, well, why is this? What's going on? Well, and if just in case you think it's just some people that are in church or philosophy that talks about this, the U.S. Surgeon General states this: our epidemic of loneliness and isolation has been an underappreciated public health crisis that has harmed individual and societal health. Our relationships are a source of our healing and well-being, hiding in plain sight. One can help us to live healthier, more fulfilled, and more productive lives simply by connecting. So we are 100% on therapy in this church, on counselors in this church. We have them as a part of our body. They are, get this, overworked trying to help people get well. Crisis lines, you're being put on hold. There's just that much happening. And you say, well, what's happening to us as a society? In the past few decades, we have just lived through a dramatic pace of change. We move more, we change jobs more, we live with technology that has profoundly changed how we interact and talk to each other, and it's detrimental. This is our life. Have I sufficiently depressed you yet? Right? This is a reality. And so where is this coming from, right? We created a society that doesn't fit us. We've created structure and things and interaction that doesn't fit us. Then what is us? Right? So there's agnostics and atheists that we talk to and we interact with, and I love interacting with them. And why? Because we talk about, well, are there any signals that we are like God? Is there any signals that God is with us? Is there any signals that what was written in the Bible represent what we do today? And I think this is one of those signals, right? I want to take you back to Genesis, in the beginning of how we were created. And I want to say it in a way that's probably 21st century, hopefully, so you'll remember it. And that's this. So if we go back to Genesis chapters 1, 2, and 3 in the creation of the world, I want you to imagine this scene. Right? So God, being in the universe, walking around, says, hey, come here, Jesus. Come here, Holy Spirit. I want to talk to you. I got this idea. Hear me out. I want to create this thing called Earth. And then I want to create these things called human beings. And I want to put them on that earth. And I want to make them like us. And Jesus says, well, what do you mean them like us? What would they do? What would they be capable of? How would they interact? I say, ah, great question. Great question. They'll have the power to be creative. They'll have the power to create life. And they'll also have the desire to be with one another. They'll have the desire to be in unity and community. Why would you think I'm saying that God put that desire in us? Because that is the part of what God is. All throughout the Old Testament, we are amazed at how many mistakes humankind is making, and it said God had a desire for his people. God rearranged things to dwell with the people. That he placed in us. It is something that can only be satisfied through a relationship with God in each other, the God that's in each and every one of you. So now we're creating a society that doesn't promote connectivity, that now is destroying that same person. That's what the data says. That's what our lives are becoming. Something that is disconnected from each other, disconnected from life, that God wanted us to have. And you say, well, why, how are you seeing that in John? Great question, right? When we look at John versus the Gospels and we pointed that out, what do we remember about as we walk through John? Say, there were some differences in John versus the Synoptic Gospels. The other Gospels talked about these majestic things, and John, right around two-thirds of the way through his writing, makes a dramatic shift. John goes from promoting miracles just like everyone else. He goes from talking about how Jesus wants justice just like everyone else, how Jesus invites those that are on the perimeter and draws them in just like everyone else. And then in chapter 13, he introduces himself as the one Jesus loves. He introduces himself as the one that Jesus loved under this guise. He says, as he's sitting next to Jesus at the supper, I am the one he's loved. What has happened before then? This great, majestic God who has all this capability, who has shown all these miracles, kneels down and washes the disciples' feet. There could not be in that time a more humble activity than to wash those that are supposed to serve you, to serve them in such a profound way. And it is at that moment John sees, hears, and experiences what he needs in order to accept what he would consider a Messiah. A Messiah that's powerful? Yes. A Messiah that is wise? Yes. But John needs a Messiah that loves. That loves profoundly. And John is not some extravagant guy. What do we know about John? We know about three things about John. We know John hung out with Jesus. We know John hung out with Peter, right? Pastor Tracy said, hey, it seems like John is always back up with Peter, listening to what he's saying to Jesus, right? When he goes fishing, John is there. When Peter goes to the tomb, John is there. So John hangs out with Peter. And then we know also that John is with the women at the crucifixion, at the cross. And then the last thing, he wrote this book. So he's not an extravagant, unique person. But John never wants to be alone. Who doesn't want to be alone? Someone that's lonely. Someone who needs and has been abandoned. That is our friend John. And John, when he closes his book that he wrote, that is only one of the four things he's known for, he says this. This is the testimony of this disciple which I have written. And we know this, that my testimony is true. That a person who somewhere existed on a scale of loneliness had a relationship by hanging out with Jesus that moved him from this moment and point of being alone all the way over to being connected and loved and calling himself beloved. Why is that important? Because some of those people are you that are also on this spectrum scale of alone, isolated, and by yourself, created by a society that convinces all of us that we should be a lone ranger. You can do it yourself. Rugged individualism. Self-made, pulling yourself up by your bootstrap, by yourself. God said, no, you can't. No, you can't. And John is in the same place as he closes his book. No, you can't. John said, if the world had written all the things, if I had written all the things that Jesus had done, it would be the largest book in the world. Well, currently, the largest book in the world is 1.3 million words. The Bible is about 800,000 words. And he says, I'll be brief. This is what's important to me. God is good, God is great, and God loved me. Does anybody need that? Do you need to know? Yes, God is powerful. Gotcha. He can win my battles. God is great. There's no mountain that we can't make it over together. Fine. But at some point, we have been created in the image of God. And we need to know we're loved. So if that is you today, if you are somewhere in the phase of your life where you may be feeling isolated and alone, I invite you not only to join us as a part of this local community online, but all of the different things that we do to get the word out to you. But most of all, I want you to grow your faith. I want you to grow your communication and meditation with God. And I want you to reach out to more than one or two people. I want your quiver to be full of friends. I want your time with friends to exceed, get this, your time worrying about work. I know, I asked for the impossible. But I'm concerned about you. Just like John is just trying to tell us. When John said, I am the one Jesus loved, he didn't exclude you from saying the same thing. Peter could have said, and I am the one Jesus loved. And mean it. Do this strange thing for me. Touch the person next to you on the shoulder, on the elbow, wherever you're comfortable. And I want you to pray with me this prayer for them. God, I thank you for my brother and sister that is sitting next to me. I ask that you touch their lives, that you be a constant companion through your Holy Spirit and through your people that exist upon the earth, that they will not be alone, but they will be like John, considering themselves the one that Jesus loved. Amen? Amen. Hopefully you got something out of it. Dana, come on with the announcements.
Feel like we need like a plaque or something to like commemorate we have completed John, or like a confetti cannon or something. Like, it feels like a big deal. thank you to all the speakers who have spoken and given us so many rich things over the last 2 years and 8 months. Looking forward to what's on the docket next. Just a few announcements as we close out our service today. The food pantry is open out in the great room after service, so if you or somebody you know is in need, please take advantage of that ministry. It is amazing, and Deb does such a great job just reaching out and helping people who are in need. If you are visiting with us, we invite you to fill out that little card so we can connect with you, say hi. We also have a gathering room over on the side here, on the, not this wall, like on the other side of the wall. I see people looking like there's nothing over there. There is a coffee room over here. We can get a cup of coffee and say hi and talk. We also have our baptism class after service today. So Pastor James is going to be leading that class. We have our baptism service at the end of the month on August 27th. So if you are interested in being baptized during that service, please just come over to the library, again, over on the other side of this wall, and come over to that class. Our sacred space gathering is this Tuesday, August 15th, from 7 to 8:30 in the library as well. So if you are part of the LGBTQIA+ community, we invite you to come out to that time of fellowship and connection. Again, just we do a lot to try to connect with each other here. And another connection point is Saturday the 19th is our Kingdom Kids annual park picnic. And that's for anyone who wants to come. It's at Bell Tavern Park in Downingtown from 11 to 3. It's kind of like a come whenever you want and have fun in the sprinklers and all the fun things that are there. So that's it for today.
So in case you're wondering what our next sermon series is, Kevin has named it, and it is called Choose Your Own Adventure. And what that means is I've been preaching in this church for 27 years, and we have always had a schedule, and we've always set up what the sermons are and gone in advance and, you know, set like 6 months at a time. I usually am the one who did that. Pastor Bob did it before. And what we're doing this time is we decided to have each preacher choose their verses that they want to use. So kind of go in, and what do you hear God saying? We've never done that in the history of this church. Which most churches do that. Most don't have a schedule. Most just give their preachers freedom to choose. So this is the first time in this church we're letting the preachers, each are going to preach two sermons, and it's choose your own adventure. So it's going to be what is God speaking to the preacher as they're getting ready for that Sunday. So it's going to be a very prophetic time. So I'm very excited about that. So let's stand for the benediction. If you are visiting us, we're so glad that you came today and visiting. We ask you to take the card that you gave out of the packet and put it in the box in the back. And I'd love to know where you are. And we just send a couple of notes and letters to you. We don't stalk. We just say hello to you. So let's pray. Lord, thank you so much that you are the one that finds us, that you are the one that sees our hearts. You see our loneliness. You see where we stand, and you chase us. Just like that first song, Lord, you do not. You are the God that rescues. You are the God that calls our name. You are the God that runs after us. And I pray that we would do that for one another, that we would see and hear and chase one another to bring them to your kingdom. Lord, I pray your blessings over each one today as we go, and I pray that we would share the beauty of your gospel message of love with a world that so desperately needs community and so desperately needs to know that they're seen. So thank you for today, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Be blessed, everybody.